Hello and welcome everyone to our webinar session from BioEngine. Today is our 25th webinar of the series. Today's webinar is on translational genomics for achieving higher genetic gains in groundnut by Dr. Manish K. Pandey from Agriset, India. Dr. Manish K. Pandey completed his PhD in plant genetics from Osmania University while working in ICAR, Indian Institute of Rice Research, Hyderabad, India. He gained postdoctoral research experience at the University of Georgia, USA for a period of 2 years. He is currently leading the groundnut genomics group at Indian International Crops Research Institute for the Semi-Arid Tropics, that is ICRISAT, Hyderabad, India. He is also an adjunct associate professor at the University of Southern Queensland, Australia. His key contributions include reference genome sequence for diploid progenitor and both the subspecies of cultivated tetraploid groundnut, gene expression atlas, low to high density SNP genotype assay, diagnostic markers for key traits, quality control panel, marker assisted pyramiding, and genomic selection in groundnut. Through genomic based breeding, his team developed two high oleic groundnut varieties, which are released for cultivation in 6 states of India. He has published more than 150 scientific articles in various journals of international repute, including Nature Genetics, PNAS, USA, and Molecular Plant. His efforts have been recognized at international level as he has been invited to deliver presentations in several international conferences to review the proposals of international funding agencies, and he is also collaborating with a large number of scientists at an international level. Recognizing his contributions, he has now been inducted in many scientific academies of India, namely Associate Fellow of National Academy of Agricultural Science or NAS, New Delhi, Telangana Academy of Agricultural Sciences or TAS, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh Academy of Agricultural Sciences or APAS, Andhra Pradesh, and member of the National Academy of Sciences, India, or as we know as NASI. He was also among the top 2% highly cited researchers in 2019, compiled by Stanford University, USA. We are highly honored to have him as our guest speaker for today's webinar. It is my request to all our viewers to enjoy this opportunity to listen to him speak about his research. I request Dr. Manish Pandey to begin the interview section of today's event. Today is our 25th webinar of the series, and we are highly honored to have Dr. Manish Pandey from ICRISAT with us today. Sir, you're quite a successful plant scientist, and we would love to know how you built your career. Could you please tell us about your journey so far as a scientist?
Frankly speaking, I never thought that I will become scientist. And from the childhood, so what happens, you see people around you, working people, different career options, and then you somehow start liking some profession.
Right.
And since my father was a lecturer, English lecturer, so I was really very impressed. You know, you go to classrooms, you can, you know, shout, just say, okay, sit down, yeah, you can have lectures, right? And then this is one side of it that you are doing a job. The other side of it that you are contributing to the society.
Right.
What I mean to say, there are jobs where you just do job and it goes to company or it goes to is just salary and you. Right. It is between you. That profession I like because it has a different angle. You are getting salary as well. And then also you are contributing to the society. And of course, teachers get lot of respect as well. So basically I was seeing from childhood how it is, so I start liking that one. So when I grow up, then I see like in fifth standard or eighth, I saw teachers, how they were like basically managing students, okay, where they want, okay, you sit down, you do when I came to intermediates or graduation, then I thought these teachers are much better than those in basic schools. when I came to post graduation, so of course, then you start and you talk about science and then research. Then I come to know, okay, there are also researchers.
All right.
And I have also an option for research, but I don't know how it is going to be. I have never met those scientists or something, whether I'm going to take wrong decision. So just I took a, you know, very safe side that, okay, let's do PhD, do some good research, and then think whether you want to go teaching or you want to go to research.
Okay.
So you can say basically from there onwards, like, I will mention names of, say, three mentors, like post-graduation I was doing in Allahabad, so basically Dr. Chitranjan Kole, where basically he just guided how genetics is the core of biology and then how it impacts the entire functioning of plants and animals and how lot of improvement or scope in career. Then I came to DRR like Hyderabad and during PhD, Dr. Enzo Barani. And then after post PhD, when I lined up in ICRISAT with Dr. Rajiv Vasne, you might be knowing him.
Yes, definitely.
And really he's like basically I have different personality. And then I come to this world researcher. So even after PhD also, I came here, okay, I will go for postdoc and then all those things. But when I have seen the environment here, I thought that, okay, I will be doing some job in US, or I got opportunity as assistant professor in Raipur, Hinuman University. But I choose an ICRISAT as a role because here I seen two advantages. One, there is no limitation, basically no one is to stop you to gain information and knowledge. You can collaborate with everyone. There is no limitation in dissemination of your knowledge and products and technologies. So basically, in addition to India, you can contribute to several other countries. So that is how basically I landed up being a researcher in ICRISAT and then being in research. So I love more in research now. I have removed basically teaching from mind time being now. So I'm happy with that. Many of the colleagues, if I met my bachelors and others, they really surprised and say, I can't believe that you will be going to research because you have never been mentioning about this career.
Okay. It's wonderful to hear your life story. Sir, you have, how have you entered into a groundnut research? Could you please highlight a few key successes you and your team have achieved so far?
So I actually did PhD in rice, and then after PhD, you know, we see that, okay, now let's have some postdocs and have different experiences. When I applied, I was looking three options. One was in ERI, and then one was in ICRISAT, and one is private company. And when I came to ICRISAT, actually, I never seen groundnut crop before that. So even interview, Rajiv Vasne asked whether you have seen groundnut or not. Then I said, no. Then backside, it was a picture of groundnut. He said, okay, I will show you right now. Groundnut in picture, at least. So that was basically the one. And then I entered in groundnut. And the good thing was, from where I left in rice, there was a need to start from there in groundnut. So basically, that is how connection.
All right. Sir, your team decoded the complete set of chromosomes of two widely cultivated peanut varieties. How does this genomic information benefit crop development and the field of research?
So basically, if you see that we have actually two species I mentioned, botanical groups, actually those are like Spanish bunch that we grow in Asia and Africa, you see little bit straighter, right? And the runner one that you see basically in US and Europe, in Australia as well, runner. So we have genomes of both kinds of both species. So when we are doing analysis, especially if we are sitting at ICRISAT, we use these relevant genomes for doing all our genomics analysis. So like these, I will say, okay, in simple example, for breeder, they need founder parents to make crosses. then only they can develop some variety.
Mm-hmm.
For a genomic scientist, actually it is a like a basic founder, basic material, basic resource, mother of all genomic resources, from where all the research starts.
Yes.
You take markers, you take genes, even if you want to do gene editing precise location, if you want to confirm. So everything is related to that. So how we are using it basically, we are using now sequencing based rate mapping, like I mentioned QTLC, WGRS. So this is how it is helping us in those. This is one, gene discovery and marker development, and the genotyping assays. Suppose we developed a high density genotyping assays, 58,000 SNPs we took from that genome. Then again, we are developing mid density. Again, we are taking best 5,000 from the genome by comparing sequencing of different genotypes. So that is how it is helping. So basically what you see work molecular breeding product that is going to the farmers, the markers used, these are coming from the genome. So precise location, that's very important. So.
All right. Sir, you have received many fellowships and awards and do a quite large collaborations. Sir, what is the driving force for your dynamic nature?
I think I never thought of this basically, although I have met with very high profile researchers, but because I already started with PhD. So one thing I was having in the mind that do little, but do the high impact. Actually, if you do a lot of things and then it is repetitive and maybe making less impact. So what happens? Science, you get some recognition, but you're not feeling happy from inside.
Right.
Because you are not contributing to the society.
Mm-hmm.
For example, like when I came here, basically, like genome sequencing, all those, these were required for research community. And then there was no high olic. So basically, when a company came to us, they said that we want high olic, but we don't want to purchase or import from outside.
Mm-hmm.
Because it will become so much costly, we cannot compete with other companies.
Mm-hmm.
So we said, okay, fund us, we will develop material, but our condition is there is no patent, nothing like that, nothing, no protection, nothing, no limitation, anybody can use it. So this is always our condition.
Mm-hmm.
We work with fund from private company, this is our condition, that the material should be freely available to everyone. So I feel once you do research, then you feel that many people will like to connect with you.
So true.
So I will say initially this was we that we were connecting with people, okay, together we can make this impact. But later on we realized that many people also they are coming up to connect with you. That's really gives happiness. So and once you have some research and all these achievements, of course these fellowships and awards will follow. So I see as a byproduct of or basically recognition in terms of these. But again, the crux is that if you focus on research that can make high impact and make sure that it reaches to the customer for whom you are doing research. So that's the basically what we are following. That is why we take risk also sometime. And when I started here, like say Lurgen, oh my God, was a huge discussion that it is not a solution. I said it's not a solution. I agree. But a person, if it is, that is exposed with 25,000 microgram per gram, if we can give a genotype, just 10 microgram, I don't know how much impactful it is. I don't know how it is used, but it will be good to have.
Right.
So that is how we pursued. And I'm happy that some companies, at least they were showing interest and then saying, okay, it's a good step. We were not aware of this, that there is a diversity, so much diversity for allergens as well. So that is how basically you come up basically. And really in science, if you are ready to fail, you will never fail.
That's a good one. Sir, you are also an adjunct associate professor at the University of Southern Queensland, Australia. Sir, is the method of teaching or instruction there different from that of India? And how is your teaching experience there?
So basically, I don't have any teaching assignment. So how I got connected with USQ is because of work. They hired, basically, they wanted somebody to guide or basically support the genomics research for their students. that team. So I got like basically letter that we want you to be adjunct faculty here and we want your support in completing or doing PhD research and then proposals, collaboration that we do. So because of that, I got and then I got associated. I have two students, joint students from there, and they are doing on different aspects. So I'm supporting my expertise from here. Likewise. So basically, I will say it's not teaching.
Okay.
It's completely on the research, and that is on the, because I have to dedicate more all the time for the ICRI side.
Right.
So that is why I have restricted basically to the research, which I am comfortable doing so.
Okay. Sir, according to you, which sectors of plant science research will prosper in the near future?
Actually, what I see basically in the last 5 years or so, every researcher is generating huge data. It's phenotyping, it's genotyping, it's sequencing. And I'm seeing that for these data science is really going to be a crucial phase.
Oh, yes.
And really, I see a great career opportunity for young ones, I will say. I will give you example, I will not name it. I have seen that even few researchers from different countries, we can't do coding, but even they are from normal biology background, they can do coding. They can write scripts, small scripts. What I mean to say basically from, we have to basically reboot our basically those postgraduate and PhD time. And then analysis, data, that area is really, without that, I think nowadays our research is really, really incomplete. Until unless you are doing total, even lab oriented, even wet lab work also, you need a minimum statistics. We need minimum analysis to put up your research. So that is how I am encouraging my student as well. I say very simple thing, saying to the saying, that if you can't eat the sweet of your own soap, that means you are not making good sweets. So I say that until unless I believe that I am eager to continue after PhD, then till then I'm not satisfied that I have done justice or you have done a good job being a student. Because you need to have some edge nowadays in career and all those things. So I just encourage them even first year and second year, I put some kind of encouragement and say, sir, okay, you should learn this, all those things. But again, it's up to the student. I say you can't make them like, you know, they should become efficient. But some of the students really, which are self-motivated, I see, they always pick up. So that is a good thing.
Sir, many of your publications showed a strong international collaboration. So what do you do or how do you successfully maintain it?
So the best mantra is we don't compete.
Okay.
I will give an example. Suppose if you go some of the meetings and we have ideas, we openly share it. And if somebody comes and we say that we want to do it, and whoever wants to come with us, we are happy to work with them. Many times people come, hey, we want to do it, but we want to lead it. Say them, okay, you lead it. Because our job as a CG center is the core activity that things should happen.
Right.
We don't want to take credit that, okay, we want to lead this, we want to lead this. We want that this should happen and the science and the agriculture that we are into, it should progress. That is our main job. So we never, even with national partners, even with proposals on I write down just objectives and discuss with them. And just first I say, you pick up the objective you want to do at your center.
Right.
Where you want to lead, you just put co-lead, and many times they choose, and then we put a proposal like that. So, and in research, we have formal, like in projects, most of the research hour is informal, not in the project, just we discuss sometime, okay, can we do together this, can you support this, all those things. That is how it is happening. That is, and because it is a like CG organization, so we don't have any limitation to collaborate with any of the country because of the political reasons also.
Right.
That makes, and the other countries also, they don't hesitate in contacting us.
Hmm.
So that is the, basically, that is the good thing. And the most surprising thing is, many of the times we are collaborating sometimes, that another one collaborator this side, another this side, and we have to make really balance, then nothing is repetitive, not telling things also, or basically discussing and then disrupting things, but making sure that we play their like cohesive role. If it is like overlapping, we try to bring them together, not to do separately. And if it is altogether different, then there is no issue. So many times, yes, there is a problem, but they understand us well. So that is why many times they approach us, because these people will be having information whether this such kind of work is going or not, or something, whether I should lead or something do or something like that. But they have been really, I should give really credit to our partners. They have been very open to us, and we have been also very open to them in collaboration in any form. That's right. How it's moving.
All the best for the future also. Sir, according to the Stanford University 2019 report, you are one of the top 2% highly cited researchers in the world. Could you please give some advice on the factors that we should keep in mind while approaching or submitting manuscripts in a journal?
So yes, that is surprising to me. Basically, it was in 2019. Yes.
And many congratulations for that.
Thank you. So I thought it's just 10 years for me, and I was not expecting actually any kind of such thing, listing the top 2% or so. Regarding journals, actually, we choose based on the journal and the audience and our work. Frankly speaking, first stage, we don't give any value to impact factor.
Okay.
We see how this is our work. It fits to this journal. And in this category, we have four options. Then, of course, we see the quality of our work. And accordingly, we approach to particular gender. And most of the times, or all the time, we pay those publication charges as well, so that it becomes open access.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. When it is open access, you might have seen that then people will cite more, read more, and then use information. So I feel that is one thing, that if we can publish in related journals, you know who the readers are, mm-hmm. then only they will read and use it, and then open access. I think you should, if you can take care, I think, to take care of those publication charges, else you should publish in those journals where they support open access or something. I think so, and I don't believe basically in impact factor. I say if your work is of high impact, no one can stop readership and citations.
That is right, sir. Sir, it was wonderful talking to you, and as a conclusion, could you please say some words of advice to the young research fellows who are watching you and getting inspired by you?
I think that's a very tricky question, and many may be unhappy with me by listening, but what I mean
No, they're not unhappy, sir. They are appreciating, like everybody's showing appreciations on the chat.
So, Soma, what is happening basically, teaching is all together. Many young researchers, they mixed up with teaching and research. And right. Teaching is all together a different ball game, where you, if you secure your job, you just keep on teaching and then job is done. Research, it's a 24 hours job. You have to keep updated proposals, research. You have to be on your toes, basically in forefront in the areas you work. So I feel if you are ready, younger person is ready to take that challenge, then only they should come. Otherwise, what is happening after few years, they, you know, start to like basically demoralized or something like that. I'm losing the race. So they should not feel race. That is why I said research, some jobs are there. If you enjoy, you like, you love, then only come make it career. Otherwise, not. Otherwise, like you can have teaching. Of course, that is a good career option, but Research means you should be ready for 24 hours on the tools. And then, of course, it is a really enjoyable. Once you start enjoying, then there is no stopping.
Yes, definitely, sir. It was wonderful watching and learning from your presentation, and many all of our viewers, all from around the world, they've appreciated, and all of the appreciations are in the YouTube chat. Sir, we will send you the other details of that. Ishuva will do.